Hello and welcome to Laranara. Today's video marks the second installment in our video series, The Vital Man, where we talk about problems that affect men as they age. And in today's episode, we're gonna concentrate on heart problems such as heart attacks, heart arrhythmias, blood pressure problems, and many more. We're gonna explain the causes and show you, of course, some natural remedies and supplements that can help you maintain a healthy heart even as you age. So let's not waste any more time and let's dive right into this and learn more about how you can maintain a healthy heart. So as we age, our heart seasons, so to speak. It grows scars, it changes. It becomes less naive and develops its own memories. And why do we say that? Because the heart provenly has 40,000 neurons of the same kind as the brain. So the heart is a kind of a brain that is specialized in processing some specific information. It is strongly interwoven with the amygdala, a thalamus, and a cortex. And there is a permanent neural dialogue between the heart and the brain. And actually, it has been proven that the heart sends more signals to the brain than the other way around. So more decisions are influenced by the heart than by the brain sometimes. And the heart processes a complex web of emotions. It's serving as stimuli for the release of specific neural and biochemical agents, the shifting of the pulse, your blood flow, changes in the heart rate, and the modification of the electromagnetic field of the heart. And the biological conflict that is linked to many heart conditions is the overwhelming stress due to unexpected negative events in one's life. And this type of conflict is always related to a person or other people. An overwhelming workload, for example, is associated with a demanding boss or with an unsupportive colleague rather than with the work itself. And whether the right or the left myocardium or both are affected is determined by a person's handedness. So due to the twist of the heart tubes, the principle of laterality is reversed. Hence, a right-handed person responds with the right myocardium. If the conflict is associated with a partner, the response will be in the left myocardium. And contrary to official theories, embryology has shown that the heart is not a mechanical pump that just pushes blood through the blood vessels. The blood is instead propelled by its own biological force due to the electrical charges of the blood vessels and the red platelets. And the heart functions as a valving system that controls the blood flow. The structure of the cardiovascular system also takes full advantage of this natural tendency of fluids for spiral movements. And by the way, the heart consists of four chambers, the right and the left atrium, which are the upper chambers, and the right and the left ventricle, which are the lower chambers, as you can see also from the picture. The myocardium is the muscular tissue that makes up the majority of the cardiac wall. And it forms the thick middle layer between the outer epicardium, which is part of the pericardium, and the inner endocardium that lines the heart cavities and the heart valves. And the contractions of the myocardium initiate the flow of blood through our blood vessels. Let's talk about those psycho-emotional stress situations more in depth. This psycho-emotional stress, those phases, they create heart cell loss, which is also called necrosis. And this heart cell loss is proportional to the intensity of the conflict. And the paralysis of the heart muscles increases with the duration of the conflict. From a biological point of view, the paralysis is an innate fake death reflex in response to a dangerous event. And the necrosis takes place on the outside of the myocardium, in the middle, on the inside, or the transmural. So it means that it can also affect all of the layers. And the loss of cardiac muscle tissue slows the conduction of the heart's electrical impulses, since the signal of the AV node has to circumvent the necrotized area. And this in turn causes irregular heartbeats, bradycardial and or tachycardial arrhythmia. And this condition is also called a bundle branch block. And if the stress and the conflict persists, the thin myocardial wall might rupture with blood flowing into the pericardium, which is called transudative pericardial effusion. And such a rupture causes a cardiac arrest. With lasting conflict activity, the heart muscle becomes weaker, and this results in physical weakness like difficulties climbing stairs or walking even short distances. And this is due to the reduced ability of the heart to carry sufficient amounts of blood into the body's circulatory system. And this is medically termed a myocardial or cardiac insufficiency, colloquially also called a heart failure. If the left myocardium is affected, the decreased heart muscle contraction slows the blood flow in front of the left heart. And with an intense conflict, the backup of fluid collected in the lungs leads to acute shortness of breath due to the rise of pressure in the lungs and to a lung edema. This is also called a cardiac pulmonary edema. If the right myocardium is affected, the congestion of blood occurs in front of the right heart, and the subsequent accumulation of interstitial fluid in the capillaries creates a peripheral edema with swelling, particularly in the ankles, feet, and legs. In the conflict active phase that involves the right myocardium, the blood pressure is also elevated. The brain CT that you can see on the right here belongs to a right-handed man who suffered an overwhelming stress conflict when his wife left him with their children. And the brain scan shows the impact in both myocardium relays in the cerebral medulla associated with this mother-child and partner side. And the scan also shows an HH focus in the brain relay of the coronary arteries, which are the red arrows in the picture, which reveals that the man experienced at the same time a territorial loss conflict. And of course, to any conflict, there is an active conflict phase, and then there is the healing phase. And during the healing phase, the necrosis of the heart muscle is replenished through cell proliferation. And with an inflammation, the condition is then called myocarditis. The paralysis of the heart muscle and the related symptoms such as a shortness of breath, physical weakness, elevated blood pressure, they all appear in the healing phase. Reoccurring healing phase due to continual conflict relapses causes an enlarged heart that is called cardiomegaly. And during the healing crisis, the brain edema is expelled through a sympathicotonic surge. And this is the period when a myocardial heart attack occurs. The myocardial infarction is initiated in the brain, controlled from the motor cortex. The myocardial attack manifests as contractions of the heart muscle with painful cramps, also known as a heart epilepsy. And an intense healing crisis can trigger a generalized epileptic seizure with convulsions that involve the whole body. And this can potentially lead to a wrong diagnosis such as epilepsy. The rapid contractions of the myocardium cause also tachycardia, which is a fast heartbeat also referred to as heart palpitations or ventricular fibrillation. And this is, by the way, different from atrial fibrillation that is related to the smooth heart muscles, and the ventricular tachycardia is related to the coronary veins. The fast heartbeat serves the purpose of ensuring the transportation of blood to and away from the heart. And the strong heartbeats are typically felt in the neck area. If the contractions are severe, the heart muscle might tear, leading to a cardiac tamponade with blood leaking into the pericardium, which is a myocardial perforation in the conflict active phase. And this is usually the case if the heart muscle has already been worn out and scarred due to many conflict relapses. With water retention, rupture is more likely to happen, and under normal circumstances, the smooth part of the ventricular muscles is able to prevent this rupture. The myocardium is also functionally closely tied to the diaphragm, which is the main muscle of respiration, because the brain relays of the diaphragm are located right underneath the control centers of the myocardium. Hence, the myocardial heart attack is always accompanied by a diaphragm cramps and breathing difficulties, notably with a right myocardial heart attack since the wall of the right heart is firmly attached to the diaphragm muscle. Next, let's talk about heart attacks. Typically, the healing crisis is brought on during periods of rest or often during sleep. And a healing crisis occurs as a single event or appears in sequences, for example, nighttime coughing fits. And in the case of the myocardium, this presents itself as a sleep apnea with episodes of cessation of breathing that can last from a couple of seconds up to 2 minutes. And this is generated by the contraction of the diaphragm. And sleep apnea is essentially a series of mini myocardial attacks with short diaphragm cramps. Chronic sleep apnea indicates that the conflict relapses triggered by tracks that were established when the original overwhelming stress conflict took place, and dreams can also evoke conflict relapses. Sleep apnea is more likely when the left myocardium is involved because the right diaphragm can't expand as much since the liver is positioned directly underneath it. Conventional medicine knows only one type of heart attack. According to the standard theory, an acute myocardial infarction or an anterior myocardial infection or posterior myocardial infection is caused by cholesterol plaques or a thrombus in the anterior or posterior coronary artery that presumably blocks the blood and oxygen supply to the heart muscle, resulting in the heart attack. And in spite of the evidence that a majority of people who suffered a myocardial heart attack had no coronary artery occlusion and normal cholesterol levels, the coronary artery obstruction hypothesis still prevails to this day. And the myocardium and coronary arteries originate from different embryonic germ layers, and they are controlled from different areas of the brain. They are linked to different biological conflicts, therefore, and cause, therefore, also different types of heart attacks with very specific and predictable symptoms. A characteristic symptom of the myocardial heart attack is an acute change of blood pressure due to the distinctive pathways of the two circulatory systems. The right myocardium initiates the flow of blood to the lungs, which is the pulmonary circulation, while the left myocardium moves the blood via the aorta to the rest of the body, and this is called the circulatory system. Since the distance of blood traveling from the heart through the entire body is much longer than from the heart to the lungs, and therefore the left ventricle requires more initial force or more pressure than the right heart muscle. And this is also a good explanation for why the left myocardium is more serious and often in an acute situation. If the heart attack involves the right myocardium, the blood pressure in the left heart chamber increases quickly, leading to hypertension. And the blood pressure is already elevated in the conflict active phase, as we've discussed, and in the healing phase due to the paralysis of the right heart muscle. And during this healing crisis, the blood pressure rises significantly higher in order to compensate for the uncoordinated contractions of the right ventricle. Hence, the elevated blood pressure does not cause a heart attack, as claimed, but is instead a vital compensatory symptom during the right myocardial attack. And with a heart attack linked to the coronary arteries, the blood pressure remains in the normal range. Sustained elevated blood pressure can distort the muscles of the myocardium where the heart valves are attached. When we talk about what happens to our heart as we age, we also need to talk about the hormonal changes in our bodies. Because the heart actively creates a bunch of essential hormones such as atrial natriuretic factor, or ANF for short, or the brain natriuretic factor, also known as BNF for short, and the calcitonin gene-related peptide, or CGRP for short. The ANF regulates blood pressure, body fluid retention, smooth muscle status, and electrolyte homeostasis. It also affects the brain, the adrenal glands, the kidneys, and the body musculature. And it decreases aldosterone production in the adrenals and inhibits the production of cortisol. And the more the heart produces ANF, the lower the cortisol concentration and less stress in the body, therefore. CGRP acts synergistically with nitric oxide to relax the blood vessels and to protect the arteries from atherosclerosis, coronary disease, and strokes. Inflammatory agents such as prostaglandins, histamine, bradykinin, and lactic acid, they trigger the release of CGRP so that the blood vessels can dilate. BNF is a neuroprotector that activates specific pathways in the neural cells that cause beta amyloid secretion. And when we are cared for, the heart releases an entirely different cascade of hormonal and neurotransmitter substances than in hopeless situations. Falling in love, for example, creates an expansion of the heart, a flood of DHEA and testosterone, as well as dopamine and also more IgA, and this stimulates also the immune response. The heart contributes significantly also to sexual hormone secretion. There are more testosterone receptors in the heart than in any other muscle or organ in your human body. Testosterone is essential to create good healthy muscles. And the heart makes also an androgen binding protein, or ABP for short, that is very similar to the one made in the testis Sertoli's cells to concentrate DHT and testosterone in the heart. And testosterone is a major factor for the release of nitric oxide for arterial dilation as well. And the more stress a person experiences, the lower the ANF and the higher the cortisol and adrenaline, and the lower also are the DHEA levels. Low free testosterone, high estrogen and androgen levels, they are all significant heart disease factors for men. High estradiol levels also lead to an aging process for the heart in men. And this is the reason why hop beers should be avoided. As free testosterone decreases and the ratio of testosterone to estrogen increases, all cardiovascular risks increase. Because triglycerides increase, the blood pressure rises, insulin levels increase, abdominal fat also increases, lipoprotein levels increase, fibrogenin increases, and energy levels decrease. And starting already at the age of about 35, the secretion of the body own hormone called strophantin decreases also significantly, and thus the oxygenation of the heart muscles becomes less and less possible. So it becomes less properly oxygenated, and this leads to the heart muscles going into a lactic acidosis, meaning that the pH drops below 6.8 and the lysosomes are being activated and start destroying the heart cells, which leads then in the end to a possible heart attack. And with all that understanding, let's come to some ways in which you can help your heart out as you age. So to maintain a healthy heart, you need a balanced level of hormones. And this includes also healthy nutrition, enough exercise, but most importantly, less stress and more love. But you also can help your heart out with some natural remedies. And here are some that we can recommend. Androgen replacement therapy. You can see here our Vital Man Tonic that I'm going to link in the description box below for that. DHEA 25 to 50 milligrams per day, magnesium glycinate 3000 milligrams per day to prevent spasms or cramps at heart muscle levels and also prevent the deposition of calcium in your arteries. L-carnitine 2 to 4 grams per day. It's a great food for your cells in a whole organism, but also specifically in your heart. L-arginine 2 grams per day to dilate the blood vessels. Grapeseed extract, also known as OPC, about 3 capsules per day or 300 to 600 milligrams per day. Ubiquinol or CoQ10, 300 to 600 milligrams per day. Vitamin C to repair the collagen damages, 3 grams per day. Potassium to support the sodium potassium pump, it is essential for life and heart health, 300 milligrams once or twice daily. Google 500 milligrams 3 times per day to avoid circulatory disorders. Ginkgo biloba 160 milligrams per day increases blood flow in the peripheral vessels, the same by the way as OPC. Or go to cola 60 milligrams per day to alleviate venous circulation and treat the varicose veins. Natural remedies also to prevent a heart attack, a stroke, and to heal angina pectoris, to balance the AFib and the heart arrhythmia, and also regulate your blood pressure. Great ones, the most important one, because as you have seen in the presentation, it is also naturally produced in your system, but as we age less and less so, is strophanthin, 3 milligram tablets, twice or 3 times per day. Link in the description box below. The Habesso Heart Elixir, also linked in the description box below, works great. And we also recommend a nice little handy inexpensive device, the Infirum, that helps you monitor and reduce or increase your blood pressure as you need it naturally without any medications. Link also in the description box below. And also breathing correctly increases the carbon dioxide concentration in your blood, should be at about 6.5%, which is a great agent, or the best one actually, to dilate the blood vessels and to buffer the blood pH and make it stay where it should be, between 7.35 and 7.45 pH. And also a nutrition low in carbs, ketogenic or Johanna Budwig diet, and intermittent fasting, they really help your heart out. I've already mentioned it, also pay attention to your exercises, stay on the move. Walking is enough if you do it for 30 minutes or 1 to 2 hours per day. And also practice some stress relief techniques, emotional release techniques like yoga, qigong, or whatever fits your lifestyle best and what you like the most. But try to manage the stress levels, because as you have seen, this is one of the major causes of all these heart diseases. And with all that being said, I hope that you've enjoyed today's presentation. If you did so, please do not forget to like, share and subscribe. If you have questions, shop at lyranara.com. Complete contact information, including our toll-free phone numbers, is also in the description box below for you. Give us a call, contact us. We like to advise you on what is best for you. And until next time, stay healthy.